So we're not going to have a class next week, and we'll meet in 2 weeks. Okay, so we'll see how far we go. I'd like to finish these set of slides today, if possible. Okay, but feel free to stop, because today I'm going to introduce some new ideas. Okay, so what we did in the last lecture, bunch of things, but the essence was that we talked about viscosity theories of the liquid. And by liquid, you remember that I mean equilibrium liquid above the melting point, as well as supercooled liquid. I'm not distinguishing between them. Okay. And that there are empirical equations, of course, but the sort of phenomenological model is the Adam Gibbs model, which is given by this equation. Okay, and basically it has this fitting parameter, which is sometimes written as A, log of eta infinity, and B, and S sub C is the configurational entropy of the liquid at temperature T. So this has been an important model for a variety of reasons. It was introduced in around 1965, and partly because people are trying to still work out a rigorous theoretical basis for this equation, which is not clear yet. There are a lot of hand-waving arguments, okay, which are not bad, but still they're hand-waving. And the second thing is that it connects a thermodynamic quantity, namely the configurational entropy, with a dynamic or a transport quantity, viscosity. Okay, so this connection between thermodynamics and kinetics is has also generated a lot of interest in over the years. Now, a lot of people, there's a lot of discussion of what happens when the configurational entropy goes to zero. If it goes to zero, it's not clear. But if it goes to zero at some finite temperature, then the viscosity becomes infinite. And as I pointed out in the last lecture, that temperature is called TK, where this goes to zero. That's a hypothetical temperature. Okay, it's not clear whether it exactly happens or not. But I just want to emphasize that this equation by itself does not say that there is a Cosman temperature. Okay, it simply is a connection between viscosity and configurational entropy. The configurational entropy does not have to go to zero, okay, according to this equation. If it does, then viscosity will diverge. But the Adam Gibbs model is simply the connection between viscosity and configurational entropy, okay? So we need to talk more about this configurational entropy. It's a very exciting and sort of complicated topic, but the way we introduce is that the configurational entropy is basically, and I'm just going to use sometimes C, okay, this is configurational, that the liquid configurational entropy is simply the total entropy of the liquid minus the vibrational entropy, okay. We sort of separate the vibrational and configurational. So you subtract the vibrational from the total, you get configurational entropy. The vibrational entropy of the liquid is basically given by its vibrational heat capacity divided by temperature. Remember the equation? There are only a few equations that you must remember. One of them is this. that is okay, where this is the configurational heat capacity. Okay, so and the same thing you can write for vibrational. S vibrational is okay, and the vibrational heat capacity is about the same as the crystal heat capacity. You can extend that above the melting point. Okay, and so you can write the vibrational entropy of the liquid as simply integral from 0 to T of the vibrational heat capacity of the liquid, which I'm approximating by crystalline heat capacity divided by temperature. There's a dT here. OK, that's missing, a little dT. And the vibrational entropy of any material always goes to zero at absolute zero. So that the value at absolute zero is zero for the vibrational entropy, okay? And for the liquid, total liquid entropy, you can be worked out again. You know the entropy of the liquid at the melting point. Okay, that's one temperature we know the absolute entropy of the liquid, because we know the absolute entropy of the crystal up to the melting point, and we know the entropy of fusion or entropy of melting. Okay, so we know this, and then we can use that as a reference and integrate that. Okay, so that's basically the idea. Okay, we'll talk more about this. I'm putting an approximate sign because we'll see what exactly that is. There's a okay. Couple of remarks that the configurational heat capacity is never negative. Okay, neither the vibrational entropy nor the configurational entropy is ever negative. They can be zero, but not negative. They're always, and it always increases, or I should say, never decreases with increase in temperature. Okay, it sort of reaches a saturation value at very high temperatures. Okay, and the reason for that is that the slope of this with temperature is the heat capacity, and that's always positive. Okay, so it has to increase. It cannot decrease. At the most, it can go to zero, okay, which is the saturation point. Okay, we need to understand what we, okay, this is just an example from MD simulations, okay, of silica, okay, silica glass, and there is a, without going in, I'll come back to it in more, just wanted to show you a variation of configurational entropy with temperature, okay? So it's sort of, these are for two silica glasses, this is simulation, so they have simulated silica glasses of two different densities, okay, using a certain potential, it's called BKS potential, very standard potential that's used for silica. Anyway, the point that I'm trying to make that it always increases with increase in temperature, and even in simulations, they cannot simulate at very low temperatures because simulations are just like real experiments. You need time to equilibrate. And so these simulations are done at high temperatures, so these temperatures are very high, but you see that the configurational entropy comes down, and this comes down, and then they don't know what happens. You know, these are extrapolations and all. I just wanted to show you some results on that. Okay. Yeah.
That temperature where the entropy goes almost zero there. for the red tube means that at that temperature, the atomic mobility is not more, it's not possible to change the configuration then. What is the meaning?
Well, yeah, this is, I'm not, this is simply an extrapolation. This is the data point. They're simply extrapolating this curve. Okay, this is the lowest temperature data point they can go. Okay, there are no calculations below this. But this is when it goes to zero, if it goes to zero. Okay, like the green, they're not sure that it may not go to zero. It curves a little bit. Okay, so they're not sure. I mean, this is, one needs low temperature experiments or simulations, but that's not possible right now. But if it goes to zero, then you're right that the viscosity will go to infinity and there is no, the system will not be able to change its configurations, okay, if it does, okay. But this is highly debatable. This is just, this is, they just wanted to show that you know, it's not clear what happens basically at low temperatures, okay. Any other questions? And we'll come back to this point in a big way, over and over again. Okay, this is one of those temperature. This is called the Cosman temperature, and it has dominated the topic for the last 50 years or so. Okay, but there is not any data. There is no simulations. So, you know, there are all kinds of speculations, basically. Anyway, so I want to go to, today I want to introduce this, the goal is to try to explain what the physical meaning of configurational entropy of a liquid is, okay? And in my opinion, the best way to understand this is to examine or learn this, what's called the potential energy landscape, or in short, PEL formalism. It's sometimes just called energy landscape, or some people even just, you know, in papers, in, they just call it landscape model, okay? But it's not a new theory. I want to emphasize in step one, it's not a new theory. It is just a way of looking at physics, okay? That's basically, but it is very useful, okay? It is very, it has given a lot of insights. So let's look at first, so I'll go through slowly. Feel free to stop and ask questions because I think it's, it'll take me the whole today's lecture to get up to some. So I want to introduce some basic ideas, very basic ideas. Okay, so in real life, in science, and, you know, we're looking at a system, and no matter how small a system is, still it is what we call a macroscopic system. It is still has 10 to the power 20 atoms or 10 to the power 23 atoms. You know, no matter how small you go, we are examining only at macroscopic system. If there is a system of 5 atoms, for some reason, if you happen to get down to that level, then it's not a thermodynamic system. It's a mechanical system where these atoms are interacting, and you can work out the Newton's laws of motion and the dynamics. Okay, there is no. So we're always looking at this large number of atoms. Large number, I call them sometimes particles or atoms or molecules. Okay, so we examine these system or study the system at two different levels. That's very important to understand, that we are in the laboratory when you're measuring properties, and in the thermodynamics, we are looking at what's called a macroscopic level. Okay, we don't have any idea of atoms. We don't even think of atoms. We're measuring properties, we're putting something and doing some measurements, okay? There's no concept of atoms and molecules involved at this level, okay? And then there's the atomic level picture, okay? What the atoms are doing, and that's called microscopic level or atomistic level, okay? The word microscopic is used for that level. So when I use the term microscopic, I mean what's happening at the atomic level. We don't study that at the experimentally or by simulation. So basically, at the macroscopic level, we have thermodynamics. We study systems in the lab in various situations. Here are three situations that are identified. Okay, you can have a completely isolated system. So its boundaries are fixed. Okay, no atom can go in and out. Okay, its volume is fixed and its energy is fixed. There's nothing. Okay, of course you don't study that in actual lab because there's no way to interact with the system under these conditions. Okay. But this is called an isolated system. And in this case, we know from the second law, the entropy, if there's something, some irreversible process in the isolated system, the entropy always increases. Okay, and in this case, the entropy is given by this Boltzmann's equation, K log omega. Okay, now, for the isolated system, at the microscopic level, the atoms are still moving around inside that isolated system, okay? And you can, in what is called a statistical physics, this is called a microcanonical ensemble, okay? I'll talk a little bit about that, okay? Or you can study a system under isothermal conditions, okay? By that I mean that the system is in a furnace, in a heat reservoir. You control the temperature of the system, okay? You put the system in a furnace, you set the temperature, and the system reaches that temperature. However, its volume is fixed, and the number of particles also are fixed. They cannot go in and out. But the system can exchange, oops, what happened to my arrow here? It can exchange energy with the furnace, which is the heat reservoir. You know, if there's something happens in the system and the system needs a little more energy, it draws the energy from the heat bath or the furnace, heat reservoir, to maintain the same temperature, okay? So you're controlling the temperature. Okay, and in this case, an irreversible process inside the system means that the Helmholtz free energy decreases. Okay, I'll not go into all this. I'm just pointing out this system is called thermostated system, or in the language of statistical physics, is called canonical system. Okay, which means it's a system in contact with the heat reservoir. Okay, so its energy is not fixed, its temperature is fixed. It can exchange energy with the reservoir, okay? Its energy fluctuates, okay? That's the main thing. Now, a lot of the theories are done in this situation where the independent variables are temperature, volume, and number of particles. Okay. In this case, all these thermodynamic parameters depend on temperature, volume, and N. And the entropy, total entropy, is given by Gibbs expression, which is minus the Boltzmann's constant times Pi log Pi, where I'll explain in a second what the Pi is the probabilities of being in a certain configuration. Okay, the entropy does not depend on, in this case, it depends only on temperature. You cannot define the energy of the system. the energy of the system is fluctuating, is variable, okay? We can talk about an average energy and all that, but there is no fixed energy of the system like fixed volume or fixed temperature, okay? So here the entropy depends on temperature, not on energy. Okay, that's a, and then there's a, the actual, most of the time we do in the lab experiments where you have fixed number of atoms. So it's closed system. Closed means that N is constant. The atoms cannot go in and out, okay? But you have, you control the temperature so the system can exchange energy with the heat bath, and its volume can increase or decrease. So what you're controlling is the pressure, okay? When you control the pressure, the volume can change, okay? So there are volume fluctuations. Okay, so in this case, the volume is not defined. I mean, it's fluctuating. Okay? You can define an average volume. And again, you have, for this situation, where the variables are temperature, pressure, and a number of, think of a one-component system right now for all this. Okay, just one-component system. Don't worry about, you have what is called Gibbs free energy, which always decreases for an irreversible process. Okay, it's a function of temperature, pressure, and N. These are equivalent. You can go from, if you know this, you can calculate this or this, or if you know this, you can calculate this. This is the thermodynamics. You can go back and forth. Okay, and this is called isothermal isobaric ensemble, okay, in the statistical physics. Now, the reason in statistical physics is that, I'm going to talk about this canonical or isothermal system, temperature, volume, and number of particles. So that's my macroscopic state or thermodynamic state. If it's thermodynamic state in equilibrium, then these quantities are fixed and they're not time dependent, okay? Temperature, volume, and N. I'm going to call it Y. Okay, so for a given Y, or macroscopic state, the atoms, now we know there are N atoms, and there are, N is very large, 10 to power 23 or so, okay? We define a microscopic state, or microstate, by the coordinates of the atoms and the velocities of the atoms. So there are, each atom has 3N coordinates. Each atom has 3 coordinates. So N atoms have 3N coordinates, okay? And these are the position vectors of the N atoms. And these are the velocity vectors of the N atoms, okay? So this is called the microscopic state, okay? We specify where each atom is. We suppose, this is theoretical, where each atom is. So I know exactly where each atom is sitting, what its velocity is, and okay, so these are 6N variables. There are 3 of these 3N, position coordinates and 3 in velocity coordinates. Now we don't know because here there are only three variables at the macroscopic level defining the system. And at the microscopic level we have 6 times 10 to the power 23 coordinates. So there's a lot of averaging. There are a lot of these microstates that correspond to the same macroscopic state. Okay, so you specify a thermodynamic states that in principle allows a lot of microscopic states are possible which are consistent with these variables. So all of these, no matter what positions you give, they will give you same volume, same number of particles, and same temperature. Okay, so the statistical physics is basically is a science that tells you how to average, how to go from here, from the micro description, micro to the macro description, okay? And there's a lot of averaging, or because we only know these variables from the macroscopic point of view. And for a microscopic state, we don't know what it is. But we can only talk about it in terms of probabilities. Probability, the system might be in microscopic state number one, or probability that it may be in number two, okay? So we can talk about probabilities of these microscopic states, which are consistent with a known macroscopic state, okay? So we need to then do all kinds of averaging, okay? And once you integrate over all the possible velocities of the atoms, then frequently we talk about a configuration state, which is the 3N positional coordinates, okay? So this defines exactly the positions of the N atoms, okay? I call that configuration. That's a microscopic. And I say, I know a configuration. I mean, atom number one is sitting here, atom number two sitting here, just like I know where you guys are sitting. Okay, exactly, okay? So that's called the configuration, okay? I'm gonna represent simply by x. It's x is equal to 3n coordinates, okay? So this is the idea of statistical physics. It only talks about probabilities of microstates, and we can write down these probabilities for the canonical system. You can do the same thing for Well, these are always, the microscopic state is not fixed. The atoms are always moving around. You know, even when the macroscopic state is fixed, it doesn't change with time. The microscopic state is always changing with time. These atoms are always moving around. Okay, that is the most important thing. Yeah, it's a function of time. Okay, it's not one microscopic state. So at a given time, it will be something. Then even if one atom moves, I have a different configuration because this number is different. Okay. Is that clear? So microscopic state is always dynamic, is always moving around, very rapidly. Okay. So the potential energy of a configuration X, that means, again, I want to emphasize, X means I know positions of each atom. You know, I cannot measure that or laboratory. So this is all theoretical. Okay. So if I know the position of each atom, then I can calculate the distances between atoms. I can calculate how the atoms will interact, because the atoms always interact with each other, like ions interact by Coulombic interaction. Atoms have interactions. Okay. These interactions are the reason why we have condensed phase. If there was no interaction between atoms, the atoms will behave like ideal gas, okay? There'll be no interaction, okay? The fact that we have liquids and solids and all that is because that indicates that atoms interact. They like to be close together when you reduce the temperature, or when you apply too much pressure, they repel. Okay, if you bring the two atoms too close to each other, then they will repel. But if you take them far apart, they will attract each other. These are called atomic interactions. So atomic interactions are pairwise. You count two at a time, okay? Or they can be many body type of interactions where you have three atoms interacting with each other, like in a covalent interaction where you have bonds constrained. And when you constrain bond angle, then you have at least three atoms interacting together, okay? But in a Coulombic interaction, you have only two ions interacting with each other. So you have pair interactions, three body interactions, four body interactions, so on. Okay, many body terms. It's complicated. Okay, so, but let's just think of right now as pairs. Forget about higher order interactions, okay? So this is called pair interaction. So pair interaction means that two atoms, I and J, okay, this I and J, the interaction energy depends on where the atoms are at their positions, okay? And frequently, the interaction energy between two atoms depends only on the distance, not on the two separate vector positions, but simply on the distance between the two atoms. So this is the distance between the atom I and atom J, Rij. Okay, it's given by this. It's a magnitude. Okay, these are called, so, okay. So I can take a microscopic configuration. Here it is, you know. Here is my atom 1, atom 2, atom 3, atom 4, 5, 6, whatever, n. Okay, and I take one and count its interaction with everybody else. Okay, I take two and count its interaction with everybody else. Three, and I can add up all these interactions, interaction energies, and that is that summation sign. I add up all these pairs. I make sure I don't double count and all that, okay? And I get the total pair potential energy of the system. This is the potential energy, simply the energy of interaction between the atoms. So you think of these interactions as springs between the atoms, atomic pairs. So it's coming from that springs, okay, between the atoms. Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
At that point.
Okay.
We are saying about liquid.
Yeah.
And this is a very general interaction, I suppose. Are we?
Yeah.
Must at this point suppose the interaction type, what I mean with that. Suppose that in the solid state, when the liquid goes to the solid state, the interaction will be covalent or ionic?
No, okay, good question. Good question. The interaction does not change, it's the same. Whether you are in liquid, solid, anything, it is the temperature. We'll come to that, okay, that changes, okay? And this is the most important thing, because even simple, you can do these so-called Leonard Jones, and they will form gases at high temperature, liquids at middle, and at low temperature, they'll become crystals, okay? So the interactions do not depend on temperature. They are the same, whether in crystal, yeah.
Then I have another question. If I suppose a covalent interaction,
yeah.
It will have meaning when I suppose that much more pairs will interact if covalent binding is always between pairs, there is...
Well, covalent interaction could be, normally I think of covalent interaction as between pairs, or it could be if it is sp3 hybridization, then it could be between three particles, like angular constraints coming in.
Yeah, okay, because an atom can have more than, can have many neighbors.
Yeah.
If we're thinking hybrid binding, can have, 5, 4, 6. Seven.
Yeah, we're not right now in this picture right now. I'm just picking a configuration out of a bucket. You know, here's position one, here's atom two, atom three, and I calculate. And I assume right now that system has only pair interactions. If it has covalent interactions, I'll have to add the covalent interaction, which could be pair or could be a three-body interaction, okay? Then I'll have to include the three-body interaction for covalent interaction. And people have that simulations. So it depends on what interactions you select. You get a different system. But for a given choice of interaction potential, you have a fixed system which will behave all, which will show all the thermodynamic behavior, gases, liquids, and all that, everything. Okay, the interactions do not depend on temperature. Okay, for a given, so this is my definition of a system, how the atoms are interacting. Okay, like inert gases, you know, these are just barely interacting with each other, and you can assume them as Lennard-Jones or pair interactions. On the other hand, water has a strong covalent component, and I'll have to add some three-body interactions and other things, okay? And there's a lot of debate about those, how to include all that, you know, the equations of those. Is that clear to you? So the point is that theoretically, conceptually, not just to stick with me conceptually, that I can pick different microscopic configurations, okay? Choose. I put an atom here, put an atom there. I can calculate the total potential energy if I know the interaction energy, interaction potential form. Okay? I can vary the microscopic configuration. I can keep calculating the new potential energy. So I can calculate this total potential energy as a function of microscopic configurations. Conceptually, I can do that. I can, you know, I can have infinite number of graduate students, and they're all calculating these potential energies. Okay, it can be done. You give me. I have not specified here what the interaction is. All I'm saying right now is let's just, for simplicity, assume pair interactions, just so that we can. You can do the same thing with triplet or four particle interaction. Okay, so here is some examples of pair interactions. These are like what the theoreticians examples. Okay, these are not the realistic interactions are much more complicated. Even simple Coulombic interaction is much more complicated. Okay, so the simplicity. Think of two atoms. This is distance between the two atoms. If the two atoms are far apart, there is no interaction. Okay? But they're hard spheres. It's like steel balls. They cannot overlap. Okay? But they can move around and there's no interaction. So this is called hardcore interactions. If they're below a certain distance, energy is infinite, which means they cannot overlap. Okay? Like steel, hard sphere. Okay, that's very simple. Otherwise, there is no interaction. Okay, so basically this says there is no overlap. You can have a little better, you can have what's called square well interaction, that there's no interaction beyond a certain distance. It's hardcore, but they like to be near each other, okay? The energy is reduced. Okay, that's, you call that, you have seen these in your elementary physics courses and all that. This is the Lennard-Jones interaction. It's given by 612 potential, okay? It has a, if they come too near each other, if the atoms are too close to each other, then the energy goes up very rapidly. What that means is that they don't like to be close to each other, okay? That if you bring them too close, they will repel. Okay, because there's a force, the derivative, to bring them, to increase R when you're here, okay? So there's a repulsion at the short range. And when they're far apart around here, then they're attractive, okay? So there's a minimum and it goes to zero, okay? That's 612. You can have other kinds of interactions. So normally we think that if the atoms are very far apart, there's no interaction energy. You know, they all go to zero at infinite. Okay, that's zero. You know, they don't know each other. They don't feel each other's presence. Okay, but we know that the atoms like to attract each other because that's what gives you the condensation liquid or solid. Okay, we also know that at short distances, they repel because you cannot compress the liquid or solid too much. Okay. Anyway, these are some theoretical examples. Lennard Jones is very common, and these things are very common. And from theory, theoretical, and just sort of conceptually keeping the picture in mind. Even the Coulombic potential is a pair potential, but Coulombic potential is a long range, it goes 1/r. It goes to zero very slowly. Okay, that's called a long range potential. So an ion interacts with a lot of other atoms. If you have only a short range potential, say like here, then it's easy to calculate the total energy because you pick an atom and only a few atoms interact with it, okay? So it's easy to do simulations. You take a Coulombic interaction, it will interact with everybody else, and 10 to power 23 summations and all that, it becomes impossible right then, okay? Anyway, let me just, here's a potential energy landscape, right? Very simple. So here's the total potential energy of the system as a function of the 3N coordinates, microscopic state. Okay, so one point here, take any point, doesn't have to be the minimum or the maximum, but any point, tells me exactly position of every coordinate of the atom, okay? And I can calculate here's the potential energy of the system. So I can generate the total potential energy as a function of this microstate, configurational state, okay? In principle, conceptually,
Yeah, there is an important question because that graph is for a time. That graph changes with time. Then the changes of position
The graph does not change with time. No, the graph is the same because for a given x, you always have same potential energy. What changes is that this microscopic state is changing with time. Okay. The graph is not changing with
time.
Yeah. The system is moving around. Okay, the microscopic state is moving around, but the graph does not change. That is time independent and temperature independent. Okay, is that clear? Because that is very important. This potential energy landscape is unique property of a system. You give me the interactions, I can work it out. And if I have enough computers and graduate students, I can generate this. Okay, and people are doing that, believe it or not. Of course, for 30 atoms, 40 atoms, 100 atoms, maybe 1,000 atoms, okay? But the point is this, that this is a schematic, because I'm plotting potential energy versus 3N variables. Okay, it is a 3N plus one dimensional surface, and n is 10 to power 23. Okay, it's called a hyperdimensional surface. Okay, it's very complicated surface, but you can calculate in principle. I can move atoms point by point by certain scheme and calculate at every position new potential energy, and I can generate the surface. Is that clear? That is potential energy landscape. Okay. I'll come back. I mean, this is very important. Okay, so the only thing that the potential energy landscape depends on is the interactions, the form of interactions. Okay, what is the rule of interaction? Whether it's Lennard Jones, whether it's Hartree-Shears, whether it's Coulombic, whether it's has a covalent three-body interactions, you get different landscape or different things, okay? The X is moving around. X is a microscopic state. That's a function of time. So the actual represented the state of the system, the microscopic state of the system is moving around all over. But this graph is fixed. So it's the surface on which you think of the state of the system as a point, and that point is moving around on the surface. Is that okay, clear? You know, this is impossible. Yeah, go ahead.
What is the more stable energy in the graph? In the plot.
Yeah.
What is a more stable energy?
Potential energy? Oh, this is the this thing that I defined. This is it?
No, she said the most stable, the lowest.
Oh, right, I'll come to, okay. Oh, I see. Oh, you said most stable. Okay, I'll come to that now. This is now, how do we study, how do theoreticians study this complicated surface? This is very complicated. I mean, I will show you, let's see if I can, may not have it. Maybe later on, I have an example. Some people have published the exact landscape for about a 30-atom Leonard Jones cluster. Okay, it's very intriguing. You know. Anyway, so how do we study this? What is the? So it's very complicated. I mean, not even the question of studying, but how to even generate it is. Will take a lot of time, but here's the interesting part, that you can study some interesting features of the landscape, okay? And these features are geometrical. I have sort of divided into two, geometrical and topological. And let's just, I'll go over them a little bit because that's the important part. That's what we are after. So you, first of all, the question you ask, what is the absolute lowest minimum energy, okay? That's called the absolute minimum or the global minimum, okay? In this case, maybe this is the lowest energy, okay? So I'll call the absolute, that's called global minimum, global, okay? Overall minimum, okay?
And that would be a crystal state, a crystalline state?
In principle, yes. I'll come to that, yes. Okay, we are not, but... This is
one.
No, it could be many. Yeah. Okay, so this is you have global minima, you have of course local minima. So these are not you have saddle points between these, and we'll talk about that. Some of these saddle points are called transition states. And we can talk about the local minima, how many are there at certain energy, okay, their energy distribution. We can talk, I'll come to this word basin, I'll explain that in a second. And then you can talk about that if you are in a one minimum, some local minimum, how do you go to the another local minimum, what path the system takes. Okay, that kind of transition paths and all that, you can talk about transition paths, barrier heights. Okay, so let's talk about, so saddle, so this is the one thing, very important, saddle state. Now normally we think of saddle state as some kind of a inflection point, okay, but mathematically, a saddle state is defined by where all the first derivatives are zero, okay? That's what I'm writing by this, that the gradient derivative with respect to the position coordinate of all the atoms is zero. So which then we say it's a minimum, or it could be a maximum, okay? It could be, these are like, just like one, you know, you have these, when you take the first derivative equal to zero, you get all these. and you get the inflection points in well, okay. You know, like, you know, this will be called the inflection point in, okay. So these are called, the term that's used is saddles, okay, for all of these. So at a saddle, there is no force on the system. Okay, it is either a minimum or a maximum. There's no net force. This is the force. The gradient of the potential energy is the force that moves the system. Okay, at this, there's no force. Okay, these could be maximum, minimum, inflection points. How do you determine whether, when the first derivative is zero, whether it's a minimum or a maximum? You take the second derivative, right? So in this case, you have, at each saddle, you have 3n by 3n second derivatives. Okay, yeah, it's okay, so you have to, these second derivatives, they, you can think of this as 3n by 3n matrix. You know, like this xi, xj. You can sort of arrange them in a matrix form, okay? When all these, and then we say the order of a saddle point, okay? So the order of a saddle point is defined by the number of negative curvatures, okay? The, where this value is negative, okay? We talk in terms of principal curvatures because these are 3n by 3n matrix, so you have 3n principal curvatures, and if you have, and the order is the number of negative, number of principal curvatures that are negative, number of, okay. So a zero order saddle means all curvatures are positive. There's no negative curvature, okay. That's zero order saddle. That is a minimum. That's a local minimum. It could be an absolute minimum, or it could be a local minimum, okay? Because all curvatures are positive, okay? A first order saddle. Huh?
How we can know that which is a positive or negative?
You take the derivative. You take the second derivative because I know phi is a function of x. I know the phi is a function of x. I take the first derivative, put that equal to zero, solve, I get the saddle points. I take the second derivatives, and I evaluate them at these saddle points to figure out whether they're positive or negative, just like you do here. Okay, exactly same thing is done in this, in these calculations. So a first order saddle means one curvature is negative, but all others are positive. So it is like a, there's one curvature where it looks like this, but all other values are positive. So it's called a transition state, okay? I'll show you, maybe I have a sketch. Yeah, okay. This is, so these are contours. This on the right, these are the contours of the total potential energy. Just like think of a hilly space, you can draw it like height contours, elevation contours, okay?
Topographical map.
Exactly, topographical map. That's what it is. So in this case, this is the same. This is actually trying to depict a three-dimensional surface. You have a minimum here. There are two minimum, one here, if they, just as an example. These are two transition states. These are first order saddles. And here on top of this hill is the second order saddle. That's like the mountaintop, okay? Or like that. So you, if you have to go from this minimum to this minimum, it's like going from one valley to another valley. You have to climb a hill, and you go through a mountain pass, which is like a transition state or a settle point, okay? And then you go down to the other valley. So in this case, you will climb up to here, transition state, and then go down to this other valley, okay? This case or this case. So this is just, so you can do all these things. See, these are, okay, and this is what people are doing. You can calculate settle states, you can calculate transition states, you can calculate which minimum goes through which transition state and will lead to which other minimum. You can do this topographical maps, and that's exactly what these people are doing, okay? Let's see. So the most important points, feature of, as far as we're concerned, for equilibrium thermodynamics, okay, considerations, are what are called the minima, the local minima, local and global minima, the minima, okay? When we talk about the kinetics dynamics, then we are also interested in transition states and probably second order transition states and so on and so forth. But for the equilibrium, let's just think of that first. We only are interested in the local minima. You'll see why, okay? These are given a special name, these minima, okay? They're called inherent structures. Okay, that's the term used, it's a terminology. Inherent structures, these are all the local minima are inherent structures. Now, okay, so the point is this, that here is an inherent structure. Here's another inherent structure, okay? IS2, IS1. All of these are mechanically stable. But by that, what I mean is that if you displace one of the atoms or few of the atoms, the system energy goes up and it comes back down, okay? Because it's the local minimum. By definition, it is mechanically stable, okay? Is that clear to you? Because it is in a minimum. The energy goes up by small atomic displacements, okay? So these are special points. You can count them. 1, 2, 3, 4. You can generate this landscape and you can count them and number them, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. You can figure out what their energy is, okay? You can, but these are special because these are metastable states. By that I mean that if you give a small changes in atomic positions, the system returns to this state. They're metastable, they're mechanically stable. Yeah.
Is this small changes only vibrational or could they be?
Well, I'll come to that. So these are the vibrational changes. Okay, when the system is in here, say, this is what, I'm gonna come to that, but this is, so suppose the system is in this little minimum, suppose, then at absolute zero temperature, it'll sit at the lowest minimum, okay, at this point. And as you increase the temperature, it will vibrate. So these are exactly, I'll come, that these are vibrational states of this particular inherent structure, okay? So each inherent structure, by definition, has these vibrational states. It's like a little local minimum, okay? And these inherent structures really what account for the configurational contribution, okay? All of these others are vibrational states, okay? So in doing all these calculations, because the total energy is proportional to the number of atoms, so normally you divide the total energy, total potential energy by n, and you plot and do all the numbers and all that in terms of the potential energy per atom, okay? That's just the scaling. And then, as I said, that I can this is the vertical axis is the energy. I can take a little slice of energy, okay, and count how many inherent structures are at that energy level, okay? You can count all that, okay? And it turns out there are many. These things go up enormously. They go exponential to the power n. These are large number. This is all theoretical. You can look up the papers. But you can see there's a factorial n comes in because in front, because for a given configuration, I can just swap the atoms and generate new configurations, okay? Just without changing the positions, but just changing, swapping the atoms. So that's what the n factorial right away in front comes in for a given, and then there are exponential to the power of a large number of these, okay? So you can define a density of states. How many inherent structures are there in energy between phi and phi plus d phi? Okay, so this is h phi times d phi is the number of inherent structures having energy between phi and phi plus d phi. This, okay, so let me show you a picture here. This is again a schematic. Okay, phi versus x. This is minimum, maximum, and these dots are the inherent structures. And you can draw a little two lines. The distance between these two lines is d phi. And you can count the number of inherent states that are in that, in this line, okay, in this band. And this is h phi d phi. So you can talk about density of inherent structures, okay? How many are there? Okay, is that clear? This, by the way, a lot of this potential energy landscape, initial concepts and calculations were developed by this person, Stillinger and Weber at Bell Labs. At that time, it was Bell Labs, yeah.
Then the vertical parts there, mean the potential energy to the configuration, but it's also the thermal energy for different temperature levels.
No. This is simply the potential energy.
The potential energy, but how the system will reach that inherent state there with thermal.
We'll add the temperature part, the kinetic energy. The temperature, when you increase the temperature, you're increasing the velocities of the atoms. That's the kinetic energy of the atoms. That's separate from potential energy of the atoms. Okay, potential energy is just the positional interaction between how far the spring is stretched, okay, between two atoms. Okay. So we'll come to that. The total energy of the system is potential energy plus the kinetic energy of the atoms. And that's where temperature comes in. Okay? But I'm not right now talking about the potential energy. As if the temperature is zero, we've taken out all the kinetic energy. Okay? So we're trying to characterize this potential energy surface, you know, what it looks like, how many minima, how many. Okay, is that clear? So the next important concept is basin, that each inherent structure is surrounded by these states, that if you reduce the energy, it comes back to this local minimum inherent structure. So for example, in this picture, all the points between here and here, if I minimize the energy, it'll come back here. Okay, but if I'm outside here, then it'll go to here. Okay, so you can, all these states that upon minimization give you the inherent structure are called the basin of that inherent structure. Okay, so you can think of these are called basins. Okay. Okay, so the, in, is that clear to you? There's just a terminology, basic, of the. So people actually do, when they're doing this simulations, they will be here, and then they will minimize the energy. Look, and when you minimize the energy, you come into the local minimum. You get to the local minimum. You don't go to absolute minimum, okay? Because you're minimizing, so you'll come down to the local minimum, okay? So these are called basins, okay? So basically, it's very important because each inherent structure is surrounded by these states in its basin, which are essentially vibrational states. Okay, let me. So, as I pointed out, that these, and I'll come back to this again, that these states are vibrational states. If you increase the temperature, you add the kinetic energy, you come up here, so you have the vibrational states, and when you remove the temperature, take all the energy out, it goes to here. So when I say energy minimization, it is same thing as saying that I'm reducing the temperature to zero. Okay. This is very interesting because now you can. Okay, this is a. This is another cartoon here of a potential energy diagram. Okay, and these are the local minima. I think these dots, these are local minima. And this is, for example, a transition state. You come up here and you go through this transition state or a settle point, and then you enter another valley. Okay. And these, all these points, this is looking down on the surface in terms of the contours. So these are called then the basins, these little regions surrounding each inherent structure is the basin. Okay. So if I minimize an energy here, I'll come to this minimum, local minimum. So you can divide this whole potential energy landscape into basins, okay? Like it's done here. Okay, each basin has only one local minimum, one inherent structure, okay? And then between the basins, you have to go up in energy, then go over a mountain pass or a transition state, then you go to another inherent structure, okay? So you have these, and here is a, this is just a cartoon, but these are the ridges. These lines are the ridges. And the minimum in these ridges is the transition pass, or the, you know, is the lowest point in the ridge is the is what you are going over when you cross into another valley. Okay. So, and this is exactly what's being calculated for all these things, okay? So you can do, right after this. So the point is this, that you can divide the whole entire potential energy landscape into a set of basins where each basin has one minimum. Okay. So I don't have in this PDF a actual calculated landscape for a Lennard-Jones cluster. I'll show you in the next class, okay? I have it on my computer, okay? So let's just proceed with this picture. And so now we can go one step further, okay? And this is important because for each of this minimum, I know exact position of every atom, right? Okay. So I can calculate pair distribution function, structure factor, because I know exactly the position of this microstate. And I can determine whether this is a crystalline minimum or a non-crystalline or amorphous minimum. Okay? So you can go there, and people are doing it. People have done this. So they know not only the inherent structures, but they know which ones are crystalline, which ones are amorphous. Okay, and you can do that, and this is just a schematic, just because I'm trying to build the concepts. So you will have a whole bunch of crystalline inherent structures, okay? And of course, a whole bunch of amorphous inherent structures. So just schematically, these crystalline structures will have lower energy normally, okay? They should. And so this is schematically, I'm drawing this. Here's the crystalline minimum, local inherent structure. And these are amorphous inherent structures. And these have various energies, the amorphous local minimum. They could be higher or lower. But some of these could be very low energy, could be almost comparable to crystal. Okay, that's what question comes in about the Cosman temperature of how low this amorphous minimum can be. Okay, but so schematically, now you can decorate this potential energy landscape, and you can decorate these inherent structures and label them crystalline and amorphous, okay, basically, yeah.
Okay, schematically, you can say that, okay, we have some minima, which are, for the amorphous state, which are really close to the minima for the crystalline state. Schematically, you can do that. But how about the calculated? You said you have a few calculated landscapes. They're close enough, or?
Well, no, I mean, these calculations have, I'll show you, because you cannot do these calculations. This is all schematic. But in the, there are also inherent structures where you may have a small region that's crystalline, and the remaining is amorphous. So it's like something like a nucleus, crystal nucleus, okay? So basically, I'm going to call any inherent structure that has a, say, a size, a crystalline size of larger than the critical nucleus size, I'm going to call it crystalline, okay? You have to make some definitions. Okay, so I'm going to then call them crystalline, because once you have a critical nucleus present, it's no longer a metastable state that can grow. Okay, we can then also you can have you can have crystalline minimum. But you can have a crystal with defects, with vacancies, and you can have metastable crystals. You can have polycrystalline regions. Okay, you can have also, it's not just like a perfect crystal minimum I'm talking about. All of those are crystalline minima. Okay, so it's not one, these are enormous number of crystalline minima. Okay. But in principle, conceptually, if you can figure out all of these, you can lump all of these crystalline minima and call them crystalline PEL, PEL of the crystal, union of all the crystalline basins, okay? And the remaining are basically all the amorphous minima, okay? And then, in the supercooled liquid, I define the potential energy landscape of the supercooled liquid. I want to turn off crystallization, okay? So I remove all these crystalline minima, and then whatever is all these amorphous minima are define the potential energy landscape of a supercooled liquid. In reality, How do we do that? But in reality, if you start from the liquid state, you are most of the time in the supercooled liquid, in the amorphous minima. You know, you will have to go through a thermally activated transition to form a critical nucleus to go into crystalline state. So we are basically saying that we are not, that is a very slow process, and by time we can turn it off. Okay, so we are not letting crystallization take place. That means we are bypassing that crystallization nodes in the TTT diagram, in the crystallization curve, okay? We're cooling rapidly, not giving system enough time to crystallize, coming from the liquid state. So we'll automatically sort of stay most of the time in amorphous minima, okay? And so in talking about the liquid properties, I only think about amorphous minima. The below the melting point, the probability, if I don't give enough time, then the probability of visiting a crystalline minimum is very, very small, so I'm sort of removing that. Okay, that's the idea here. It's exactly the same, but I can now, theoretically, I can now define a supercooled liquid potential energy landscape and look at its properties. So now I look at the, this is very important, the part. So far I've talked about potential energy landscape. Oops. Okay, this is E, capital E. Total, I have different symbols in my slides and I've been going back and forth, but. So anyway, the total energy of the system is the potential energy plus the kinetic energy of the atoms, okay? Half mass times velocity squared, summed over all the atoms, okay? Of all x direction velocity, y direction velocity, zero, okay? And by the equipartition theorem, and this in statistical physics, all this kinetic energy is simply 3/2 n kBT, where kB is Boltzmann's constant, okay? That's what you get in the ideal gas, because all the atoms have only kinetic energy. There is no interaction between atoms in ideal gas, okay? And you only have, this is the total energy of the ideal gas, okay? So the total energy of a configuration is the potential energy plus 3/2 n gain, this kinetic energy, okay? So at some finite, so at absolute zero, when T is zero, I'm only sitting on the surface. So far what I was talking about, okay? But when I have temperature, finite temperature, I have extra kinetic energy, and the system is able to explore higher energy states, okay? So this will have, the higher the temperature, the higher the energy states it can explore, okay? And if the temperature is too high, then the system will be flying above this landscape. Basically, it's like an airplane going over your landscape. It has so much high energy because of temperature, okay, that you don't see the landscape at all. It's all its properties are controlled by this if the temperature is very high. Okay, so, but at low temperatures, as you begin to reduce the temperature, you see you begin to get the influence of the landscape, hills and valleys, okay? Like if you're going in a car, or say, you know, if you are not in an airplane, okay? And so at low temperature, this is what happens in the below the melting point. The supercooled liquid are in a, what is called in a landscape influence regime. The temperatures are low enough where your system is seeing ups and downs in the valleys and hills, okay? If temperature is very high, like in a gas, then you can forget about landscape and that's just okay. So for supercooled liquid regime, especially near the glass transition temperature and so on, it is very much influenced by the features of the landscape, the minima, the barriers, the height, the elevations, okay? And most of it, when you're at low enough temperature, most of the time you're sitting in a local minimum, vibrating, okay? And then once in a while, there's a thermally activated process, you go to another minimum. You go over a transition state, a settled point, to a neighboring minimum, okay? You see that this is called thermally activated regime. Whenever you are in a thermally activated kinetic regime, you are under the influence of the landscape. You're seeing minima, barrier or settle points, okay? This potential energy landscape plays a big role in understanding the properties of supercooled liquids near the glass transition temperatures. Now, if you go to high enough temperatures, like close to melting point or something, or its temperature may be for some systems high enough that you are more or less what's called in a diffusion regime and not in a thermally activated regimes, okay? But we'll not worry about that, okay? And I'll assume from now on that we are at close to the glass transition temperature, okay, in the supercooled liquid state. Okay, so now we have very good, this picture gives us a very clean and clear separation between vibrational states and configurational states, okay? Each local minimum has one configurational state, okay? And all these other states of the basin of this minimum are vibrational states. Okay, so at some finite temperature, you're just like vibrating here, you're exploring these, okay? The nice thing in this picture is that the configurational states can be counted along with their energy. So you have how many of these configurational states are there in an energy range, okay? So you can, that's what leads to configurational entropy, okay? It's these configurational states. All this is vibrations, all these other states. But this picture has a clear, all these configurational states are isolated. They're not, they're separate from each, you can distinctly count them, okay? So if you're in a local minimum, it's as if you're in a crystalline minimum. You know, it's basically, it's vibrations, and you can use Debye theory for heat capacity here and all that, you know, for vibrational, the theories of the, for the crystalline state, same thing apply here for each local minimum, okay, for the vibrational states. Now, I'll come to the kinetics later, okay, and, but basically, when a liquid freezes, the probability of being in each configuration state gets frozen out. It remains fixed at low temperatures. So you're still vibrating in the glassy state, but this probability of being here is not changing. I'll come to that in more detail. So the glass properties are essentially vibrational. Okay, the glass is showing essentially, but again, this I'll come to later. So then we can talk about basin probabilities. Okay, what's the probability system being in this basin or this system or being in this or this? Because it could be anywhere. At a given temperature, the heat reservoir is controlling the temperature. The system, in principle, explores all these energy states, high and low, because it can draw the energy from the heat reservoir. Okay, it exchanges the energy. So how fast a system is able to move around on this landscape depends on the temperature, okay? So if it's at very low temperatures, then you don't have much kinetic energy and you get trapped into a minimum state here a long time before you go. Okay, but if you're at high enough temperature, you can move around more easily. So we have a potential energy landscape, and then the temperature comes in, the kinetic energies, how the system, how fast with respect to time, is able to explore this landscape, overall landscape, okay? Which is very important because that's the main thing that happens in liquid to glass transition. In a liquid, the system is able to explore all the entire landscape within the observation time, okay? So it's in equilibrium. That's what we mean by equilibrium. It has equilibrium probability, so I'll define that. So you talk about this probability of being in a basin 1, basin 2, basin 3, and I can I call that P sub I being the basin at whatever time, or they may not be time dependent. I'm showing you in general as a function of time. But the sum over all I has to be 1, right? The system has to be somewhere, okay, in one of the basins. And of course, the probability cannot be negative. That's another, okay. So in equilibrium, these probabilities are time independent, okay? So the system, we don't know a system exactly by one point. Okay, we are doing only theoretically, we are picking a microscopic state. But in reality, we have a physical system. We only know its macroscopic properties. It could be in any of the microscopic states. We don't know. So actually, the initial state of the system is described by a probability distribution. You could be here with a certain probability. You could be here with a certain probability, depending on how you prepare the system, okay? So in liquid, the probability in a basin is not changing with time. It does not mean the system is stationary. It simply means that it's some probability is going from here to here, some are coming here. So there is a dynamic, there are transitions taking place in a liquid state, okay? The system is moving around on the barriers, but the net probability in each basin is not changing. That's what I mean by equilibrium. It's a dynamic equilibrium. There are transitions taking place across all these barriers, okay? So in the liquid state is very dynamic, okay? All these, okay. So you can define the equilibrium probability very easily. Because in equilibrium probability, the system is simply given by the Boltzmann distribution. Okay, and this is you may have or may not have seen that before, but this is simply the Boltzmann distribution. It simply says that the probability of being in a basin I is exponential. Beta is simply 1 over kBT, okay, 1 over temperature of this, the energy, the potential energy of the minimum I, and then the vibrational free energy within this basin, okay? And this is just a normalization factor. All of these probabilities must add up to 1. So if you add up to 1, then you see the z is simply equal to sum over all this, okay? And this then factor is called partition function. And you can show that if you take the derivatives of this with the various quantities, you get thermodynamic quantities. It's related to free energy, the partition function and all that. But partition function is simply a normalization, okay? It's simply, if you sum over all the probabilities, which is equal to 1, then this gives you that, okay? So it's very simple. It is Boltzmann factor. It is exponential minus potential energy over kT, of being in this minimum. On top of that, there is the vibrational states at some temperature T. This will automatically be zero at T equal to zero, okay? So one can work out, let's see, you probably have seen that this partition function is basically given by, is the total free energy. It's related to the total free energy by e to the power minus beta f. That's the thermodynamic connection. Okay, in equilibrium, this, okay, f is the free energy of the system. So if I assume, and this is just for our conceptual discussion, okay, for simplicity, that this, the vibrational features, vibrational part of each basin is identical, okay, then I can basically take it out and it cancels out, okay, from all the sums, and I get simply a probability based on the configurational energy, potential energy, okay? And this is called the configurational partition function. Okay? So this is normally not true, okay? Normally, the vibrational states will depend on how steep is this curvature, okay? Because the vibrational properties depend on this curvature, which is related to the frequency of vibrations. Okay, so if you are at a high energy basin, it has a much smaller curvature, okay, very low frequencies. If you're at a very deep minimum, you have a very sharp curvature and you will have much higher frequency. So it's not a good approximation, and a lot of work is being done on all that. But for our discussion, we can assume that. Okay, yeah.
At the lower temperature, that will be true, because at the lower temperature, around the minimum, the function will be parabolic, and then the vibration behavior will be the same for all.
No, but it'll be parabolic, but the parabolic would be of a different frequency here than here. The frequencies of the parabola, the curvature of the parabola are different here and here. Okay, so exactly. See, exactly, sir. So these are the enharmonic, these, when it's not a parabola, then you get enharmonic corrections and all these things. And at the high temperature, a lot of these enharmonic terms come in because you are visiting mostly these high energy minima at high temperatures. Okay, we can then get the configurational properties. We can write the configurational free energy. This subscript C is configurational from the configurational partition function. And this is simply the average configurational energy minus T times the configurational entropy. Now, let me show you what that is. This is simply, with some probability you are here. We are now forgetting the vibrations, okay? With some probability you are here, some probability you are here, some probability you are here. You can then average, okay? That will give you the configurational energy of the system, okay? And this, this entropy is a, okay, next slide might have it, yeah. So here is the configurational energy of the system, the average configurational energy. I take the energy of a inherent structure, multiply by its probability, okay, sum over all, okay, that gives me the average configurational energy. And I use the Gibbs expression for the entropy. So Pi log Pi, that's the product, summed over all the inherent structures. That's the Gibbs configurational entropy, okay? That is, remember I showed you earlier in the, maybe it's a good time to just, you know, the Boltzmann entropy is only for a system with fixed energy, okay? For a system with a fixed energy, that we know the energy we have locked in, there are many microscopic states. And all those are equally probable because there is nothing we can say to separate them. Okay, all of them are equally probable. And that, for that, Boltzmann showed that this is KB log omega, where omega is the number of microscopic state structures. Okay. What Gibbs did, is he produced the expression for as a function of temperature. Okay, which is minus KV PI log PI. Okay? Where these probabilities are temperature dependent. Okay? So Gibbs is saying at a given temperature, not at a fixed energy, but at a given temperature, the system can, in principle, explore all energy states with different probabilities because it can exchange energy with the heat reservoir. Only its temperature is fixed, okay? Now, if all the probabilities are equal, suppose, let me use another color. If all the probabilities are equal, okay, I like this color, so that this will simply be equal to 1 over the number of total number of configurational states. If you put that in here, this equation becomes Boltzmann's equation. Okay, when all the probabilities are equal, then you have total entropy is simply KB log of the number of states. That's the maximum value of the Gibbs entropy. So it reaches the maximum entropy, infinite temperature. At infinite temperature, all these are equally probable. Energy doesn't play any role because temperature is very high. And it reaches the Gibbs or the Boltzmann expression. So, when you talk about entropy, configurational entropy, as a function of energy or as a function of temperature, it's important to sort of keep the difference in mind, okay, the Boltzmann entropy is when all the states are equally probable. Okay, that's when happens when you have a fixed energy and the system can be in any of the states that are allowed by these conditions. Okay, the same probability. But when you have a fixed temperature, you're putting the system in a thermal reservoir and a furnace, system can explore higher energy or lower energy states by exchanging energy with the heat reservoir. Probability of that happening varies with the Boltzmann distribution. Okay, there are different probabilities. If the energy is for a probability of a energy I is something like proportional to a minus EI over KBT, okay? So if the energy is very high, okay, the probability will be small. Okay. And energy is low, the probabilities will be large. So it becomes temperature dependent probabilities. So this Gibbs entropy is temperature dependent. It discusses, okay, so it can explore in principle all energy states, but the probabilities are of course higher for the lower energy states. Okay, so we can calculate these properties and there's a whole here. So the point is this, that in the thermodynamics, you're only dealing with the inherent structures, the local minima, okay? And these are the metastable states. The we're talking about amorphous minima here for liquid, okay? And when we do the kinetics, then the other features come in. When we talk about how fast a system goes from one minimum to another minimum, and these transitions, and then you have to ask what are those settled states or transition states, and you can talk about the barrier heights. They change from different, as you can see, the barrier heights will vary from, and you can calculate all that in principle. If you know the landscape, you can calculate all the, how many settles or transition states surround every inherent structure and what their barrier heights are and which is the lowest barrier height, which is more likely, okay, the system will go. So in, you, one can do a lot of kinetics in this picture, okay?
So, well, let me just say a few things before I forget.
Okay.
Next week, there will be a class on Tuesday morning at the physics department.
Right, right, but it will not be continuation of this.
No, but it's related because it's relaxation,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. You that's in the school.
In the international school, Professor Gupta will give a talk on relaxation in glasses.
Yeah.
Because at some stage you're going to talk about relaxation. So you're invited to be 8 o'clock Tuesday, by coincidence,
right,
in the Sergio Mascarenhas Amphitheater. The physics department, 2-hour lecture. So we have a lecture.
So here's an example of a simulation, and I'm almost done for today's. So people have, for example, taken Leonard Jones or then potentially a BKS. It stands for the three people who, what is it? I forget the names. But it goes by the name of BKS potential. It's very, very popular potential for silica, SiO2, okay? And they, for 999 ions, and this shows they will do a molecular dynamics study. So here, they have the potential interaction, BKS potential. They will start in a configuration, put the atoms randomly, okay, calculate energy, and then you know the force on each atom by the gradient of the potential energy. Okay, that's the force on every atom. So you calculate the dynamics of the atoms. You do the Newton's laws of motion, and you know, after stepwise, and you can let the system equilibrate. After a while, it'll equilibrate. Although you started out in some random configuration, probably a high temperature configuration, after a while, it'll equilibrate. And it'll begin to explore all that, okay, all the landscape. And they have calculated this average configurational energy, okay, and this is showing as a function of time. This is at 3 temperatures. So the green is at 4,000 Kelvin. These simulations are done at high temperatures because it'll take forever. They'll never get anywhere at low temperatures, okay? So the blue one is at 3,500 Kelvin. The red one is the lowest temperature at 3,100 Kelvin. And you see, after a while, there's a kinetic energy in the system at this temperature, whatever temperature. Let's look at the green. Okay, so you have a 4,000 Kelvin kinetic energy. So once you've reached equilibrium, then what they do, you stop your MD simulation at some time, at some instant of time. and you minimize the energy, again, they do by all these complex algorithms. So you are in equilibrium, you are going all over, you know, and you stop, say you are here, and then you minimize, and you come down to the inherent structure. Then you find out the energy of the inherent structure. Then they go back and let it go some more, molecular dynamics at high temperature. And you stop and you minimize and you get all these different inherent structures and you sample them and you average them. So it turns out that the number of, how often you will see this will depend on its probability, equilibrium probability. So they have done that. And this is the configurational energy of the inherent structure. Okay, there's this sample is seen after it has reached equilibrium. Okay, it's no longer in one, it's moving around. So you're here, you're here, then you do the, so you get some kind of a fluctuations, you see. Because sometimes you need a little higher energy, sometimes a little lower energy. Okay, and this, then the average of this is plotted here. I think this is 4,000 Kelvin is here. Okay, this is plotted here. Okay, this is same quantity here. Same way, this is. So they have plotted this configurational energy as a function of temperature. Okay, you can do that. Okay, this is. So the point I want to make is that at a certain temperature, the system is not in the lowest minimum. Okay, it sees a lot of, it travels around, it's moving around. So the probability is the number of times, it's seeing the inherent structures of different energy levels. And when you have high temperature or temperatures high enough, then most of the time you are way above the minima, okay? So, and you're only sampling high energy minima, okay? So, which is what's shown here. At high temperature, at 4,000 you're here, so as the temperature goes up, the average energy of the inherent structure is going up. So the system is sampling higher and higher inherent minima, or the configuration, energy configurations. Okay, because that's what the old equation was. I think I should have put it down somewhere here. Here, this equation. The higher the energy, only at T equal to zero, you will see the local absolute minimum. At higher energy, you're seeing higher minimum, okay?
Let me ask you something here.
Yeah.
Here is just the potential energy, right? So you're not taking the kinetic energy into account.
No.
So, but earlier on, you said that the potential landscape does not depend on temperature.
Yes, right. It does not depend on temperature.
It does not depend. If it does not depend on temperature, so the minima also are fixed.
They don't depend on temperature, you're right.
They don't depend on temperature.
Yeah.
So how come in there?
Because at high temperature, the probability of being in a certain minimum changes. Probabilities are changing. Yeah, so at high temperature, there's a higher probability the system is in these minima. So the average energy that the system samples of all the inherent structures keeps going up, okay? That's the point. So potential energy landscape
is
clear. Okay, that's important point. I agree. I'm glad you brought it out, because it is how the system explores the landscape depends on temperature. The landscape itself does not depend on temperature. Okay, it's the probabilities are changing. Okay, and we'll see that these probabilities change with time, temperature, and all that. Okay, And that's the, so people have done these kind of calculations. So I want to just go back to now just one, I think this is my last or the last but one slide, is that is a liquid in equilibrium is sampling all of these metastable amorphous minima, okay, with different probabilities depending on the temperature, okay? And all of these are present if you look in a sample of liquid in a lab or something. All of these structures are present, okay? So if you take a snapshot of a liquid, you will see these different amorphous minima in different subregions of the liquid, okay? On a snapshot, okay? But with time, all of these are changing, very quickly changing. So at a given location, the structure will change. It'll change from here to here, okay, at a given location in a three-dimensional space in liquid, okay? So the liquid structure is very dynamic. It is, on an average, it is homogeneous. We don't see any difference in the average structure of the liquid. But at a given moment, the liquid is heterogeneous. And also, at a given location, the structure is changing with time rapidly in equilibrium, okay? That issue about time dependence is the main thing in the glassy state, okay? So the picture of the liquid is that a liquid is dynamically heterogeneous, okay? It has regions, these of which are fluctuating in their structure. They're all corresponding to these different inherent structures, okay? And this is called the mosaic view of a liquid, that a liquid has like a cells. These are mosaic cells where these cells are changing constantly and the boundaries are moving around. They're not, you know, I'll not even talk about what controls the boundary or the size of all these regions. But that is the meaning of configurational entropy, is that a liquid has access to many of these configurations, okay? On the crystal, on the other hand, has very few configurational states available to it, very low energy, the IS, okay? That's the reason why a crystal melts. The one simple question which you must, you know, never forget is, why does a crystal melt above the melting point? You know, a liquid has higher energy above the melting point. A liquid has higher energy than the crystal. You have to supply the heat for the crystal to melt. Okay, that's the heat of fusion. You have to heat it to melt. So why does liquid is more stable than crystal above the melting point, even though it has higher energy? The reason is it's a configurational entropy, okay? Because it has so many possible structures. So even though the individual probability is small, but if you sum over all these amorphous minima, it becomes the dominating equilibrium phase. So liquid melts because of high configurational entropy. Okay, so a melting transition is an entropy-driven transition. Okay, energy actually goes up, enthalpy goes up. Okay, it's the entropy that drives the transition. Okay, so we'll see that is a reverse is also happening when you're coming down from the liquid state and nucleating crystals. You're losing configurational entropy. Okay, so this thing you will see in literature, mosaic view, and this whole debate about this is schematic. Okay, these are all, but what's the size of this and what's this? These are all amorphous minima. These between different cells of the mosaic picture, there's no crystalline minima. When I say different states, this is amorphous state, this is amorphous state, and these two are different amorphous states. You cannot go from here to here continuously, you have to go over a barrier height, okay? You have to transition into that, okay? So there are these, so these are, these boundaries are actually boundaries between amorphous minima, amorphous structure to amorphous structure. There's not one amorphous structure like crystal structure. There are many amorphous structures, okay? So let me just, I think that's my, and I'll stop here, okay, basically.
Just one question, yeah. And then just to make clear to the students, in these amorphous regions, let's say structures, they are frozen in at the 50 or at
the 50. I will come to this.
So they stay, you know, if you pick a glass at room temperature, a glass which is free of crystals, free of liquid-liquid phase separation, as we know it, they still have these heterogeneous regions. We think we have a homogeneous glass, but they're not really.
But these are, you're talking very small size, you know. Yeah. Maybe even smaller, but what was I going to say? Right. It's the, oh yeah. Anyway, when you go, you have to do these barrier heights, okay, from minimum, from here to here, and here to here. And each of these transition is temperature and time dependent. And when a liquid becomes a glass, basically, these probabilities are frozen in certain regions, okay? So you may, for example, have a couple of minima where in the glass the transitions may still take place, but it's not sampling the whole configuration space, okay? So these are very local, some small transitions, very low barrier transitions can take place in the glass, and we'll talk about that in the next lecture 2 weeks from today, the transition side and what happens at the glass transition, okay? We'll see you in 2 weeks.